Amen. Thank you, praise team, once again. Every week you do such an amazing job. Let me ask you to turn your Bibles this morning to the book of Galatians. Remember last week we started in this series. We're methodically moving our way through the book of Galatians. We started last week. We're going to finish out chapter 1 today. And as you're turning there, I want us to think this morning about the topic of religion. And more specifically, I want us to talk about the fact that I don't believe that God is too terribly interested in it. Now, I know that may seem like an odd statement to come from a pastor in the middle of a church service, that I don't think that God is all that interested in religion. But I think that that's true, that God is not interested in our religion. Because God is all about life. He's all about bringing us life. That's why Christ came. He said he's the way, the truth, and the life. God is about bringing us life. Religion, by its very nature, is lifeless. In fact, the origin of the word religion, it comes from two Latin words. It comes from the Latin prefix re, which means to do something again. If our computer, when our computer crashes, we have to reboot. We have to boot it again. It comes from re, and the Latin word ligare. The Latin word ligare means to bind or to be in bondage. The word religion quite literally means a return to bondage. Now, as we're studying through the book of Galatians, I noted last week the theme. You can't miss it. As you read Paul's letter to the churches in Galatia, you cannot miss the overarching theme to that letter, and that is freedom in Christ. That Christ has come to set us free. He said, if the Son has set you free, you are free indeed. And we can't miss that theme in Galatians. In fact, we pointed out last week that the key verse in the book of Galatians, you want to get an idea of what the entire letter's about. Get sort of the thesis statement, if you will, of the book of Galatians. Flip over to chapter 5, verse 1. There is the thesis statement for the book of Galatians. It was for freedom that Christ set us free. Therefore, keep standing firm and do not be subject again to the yoke of slavery. And if you're following along in the King James Bible, do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Do not put yourself back in bondage. Do not return to bondage. In Latin, it might say, do not religion. And so I do believe that God is not interested in our religion. That was the issue that Paul was dealing with in Galatia, you remember. He had founded these churches during his first missionary journey. And he came back and he visited them two other times. But there were Jews that came in behind him. And they were starting to teach these young Galatian believers that their relationship with God was a mixture of faith in Jesus and their own works. They said, well, believe in Jesus if you want. Faith in Jesus is good. That's not a bad thing, they taught. It's just not enough. And that if we're going to have a right standing before God, if we're going to have a good relationship before God, if we're going to be made right before him, faith in Jesus is good, they taught. It's just not enough. It had to be supplemented with following all of the Jewish religious rules. This was the message they came in and taught after Paul had established these churches. And so as we kind of finish out chapter 1 here, Paul continues his defense of the gospel, but he's also continuing his defense of his apostleship. And as he does this, I want us to peel this idea back a little bit and look a little deeper into why I believe that God is not interested in religion. The first reason I think that God is not interested in religion is because of the origin of religion. Look at verse 11 of chapter 1. He said, for I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man. For I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. As Paul lays out the origin of his message, he's drawing a contrast between the message that he is preaching, the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the message of religion that the Judaizers brought to the church. He's laying out this contrast between the two. And he said, listen, this message, the good news of salvation by grace through faith, this message could not have come from man. It absolutely defies understanding that it would have come from man. The only place this message could have come from would have been from Christ himself. Now think about that for just a minute. There is no other religion in this world that is teaching this message. salvation by grace through faith. None others. There was none other then, there is none other now. He said the only place that this message could have come from would have been from Christ. Every other of the world's religions are man-centered. Do you realize that? Think about that for just a moment. Every other of the world's major religions is man-centered. And whether it's the accumulation of good karma in to achieve nirvana in Buddhism or Hinduism, or it's the eternal scales of good works versus bad works that Islam teaches, or even if it's Mormonism, which I think is the closest probably to what the Galatians were teaching, that we are saved by grace after all we can do. Every one of those religions is man-centered, came from the heart of and mind of man. And Paul said, listen, this message, this salvation by grace through faith could not have originated here. He said to the church in Corinth, it's foolishness to him who is perishing. And that word means it's absurd. It's illogical. It's against everything our human mind wants to believe. This message of salvation by grace through faith makes absolutely no sense to the human mind. It's not something we would have thought up. Now, why such an emphasis on the works of man? Why is it that we see that the world's religions have such a strong emphasis on what we do? Well, we think back all the way to the beginning, all the way back to the Garden of Eden. What has been the central focus of man's desire from the very beginning? Man has always wanted to be his own master and his own commander. We have always wanted to be the captain of our ship, right? We've always wanted to be the one who's in charge of our destiny. Man has always wanted that. And grace takes our eternal destiny out of our hands. But listen to me, praise God, it puts us in His. It puts our eternal destiny in His hands. Boy, if it's in our hands, we're going to goof it up. Look around this world. Everything that man has had his hands on has gone from good to less good. And if our eternity was in our hands, we'd goof it up. Praise God, it's in His hands. God has taken it out of our hands. But mankind desperately wants to be in charge. We desperately want to be on the throne of our lives. We desperately want to be the one who calls the shots. That's why all of the religion that originates in the heart of man is man-centered. It always circles around what we do and how we can earn our right spot before God. And this is why these Judaizers plagued the first century church. You do just a quick sort of survey of all the letters that Paul wrote. And as he wrote to the church in Ephesus, both the book of Ephesians and as he wrote to Timothy as he was pastoring in that church, he wrote Colossians and Philippians, Romans, he wrote the book of Titus as he was pastoring the church in Crete, he wrote to the church in Corinth, even James as he wrote to the church in Jerusalem, all of them address this very same issue. That's why the Judaizers focus so much on this. Religion that is man-centered, that originates in the heart of man. That's not God-honoring, it's not God-pleasing, it's not what God is the least bit interested in. In this entire chapter, Paul is defending his apostleship. Now, he's not defending his apostleship so he can draw attention to Paul. He's not saying, listen, I am Paul, and I am an apostle, and you should be just overly impressed with me because of who I am. That's not why he's defending his apostleship. Paul is defending his apostleship because the source of the information matters. His credibility matters. You remember, there was no New Testament then. He couldn't pull out the New Testament and say, see what I wrote to the church in Corinth? He couldn't do that. There was no New Testament then. You remember as Paul and Peter and James and the other apostles, as they went around and they taught and they wrote, they were forming the New Testament. They were the New Testament. And Paul is building, he's defending his position as an apostle. He's defending his apostleship because his credibility as an apostle mattered. Because the message is only as good as its source. If Paul had gotten his message from some other man, had gotten his message from tradition, had gotten his message from somewhere else, then it's questionable. This originated in the heart of man. He said, that's not where my apostleship came from, and that's not where my message came from. We often say, consider the source, right? Nowadays, you open up Facebook, open up any social media platform, and we are inundated with a bunch of stories. Fake news is kind of the term that's floating around, but we're inundated with stories about what is happening in the world and what they mean. And every one of those things, we have an opportunity, and we really ought to, go back and trace the source that it came from. Is this a credible source, or is this just anyone who sat down at a keyboard? Because the message is only as good as its source. And Paul said, listen, the source of this message was not me. It was not anyone else. It wasn't even the apostles. If we jump down to verses 18 and 19, he didn't even visit the apostles until 3 years after he was saved. And even then, he only saw two of them, and he only saw Peter and James, and it was only for a period of 2 weeks. I didn't spend an extended period of time with the apostles. I didn't get this message from anywhere else. You can trust this message because it did not originate in the heart of man. It originated in the heart of God. And I think we can realize that God is not interested in religion, because religion in its purest sense originates in the heart of man. It's the things that we try to do to earn our spot and earn our way and earn our place before God. And we can know that religion originates in the heart of man because its main motivation is obligation. That's what religion does. It obligates us to do things. I have to do this. I have to do that. I have to follow these rules. Husbands, imagine for a moment that you've decided you're going to be husband of the year. You're going to make yourself the best husband you can be. And by the way, I encourage you to do that. So you go out on Amazon and you find a book on marriage. You don't tell your wife, this is a surprise. You're going to get this book. You're going to read through this book. You're going to learn what it takes to be the best husband that you can be. And you get this book and you read through it and you come to your wife and you're going to surprise her. And you say to your wife, you know what? I got a book on marriage and I have read through the entire thing. At this point, she's excited. And I came to this chapter and it said that what you and I need to do every day is to sit down and talk about our feelings. Now she's really excited. And honey, we're going to do it. Every day we're going to sit down and talk about our feelings. Now I guarantee she's almost about to jump out of her chair. And then you drop this little bomblet. We're going to do this every day because this book says we have to. Immediately the wind taken out of her sails. Now, she might say to you, not because you want to. Well, she might, before that, she might say, fine. Okay, guys, I've been married a long time. If you're a young guy here, let me just give you a little bit of advice. If your wife says fine, it is not fine. If your wife says fine, the first thing you need to think about is, what have I just said or done that was foolish? And what am I going to do to make it up to her? She might say fine. She might ask this. You want to do this not because you want to? Not because you want to be with me? Not because you want to get to know me better? Now, you've gone to great lengths. You've studied this book. You've read it cover to cover. And you want to show her that you really understood what this book said. You know, because the book says we have to. Now, guys, if you survive that conversation, if you live to tell about that conversation, don't expect your wife to be too terribly excited about what you have to offer. Out of obligation, I'm going to do this. And you and I, as we approach God, we can't expect God to be all that interested in what we have to offer if we approach him purely out of obligation. And we can look at religion and we say, God is not interested in religion because it originates in the heart and the mind of man. But God is not interested, I don't believe, in religion because it's ineffective. Because of the ineffectiveness of religion. Paul continues in his argument. I think the best way he can make it, certainly this is the way he does make it. So as the Holy Spirit inspired him, this certainly is the best way he could make his argument, is he points to his past. Look at the change that has happened in my life. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Look at the change that has happened in my life. That's the best way Paul can make that argument. Pick it up in verse 13. He said, for you've heard of my former manner of life in Judaism, how I used to persecute the church of God beyond measure, and I tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my contemporaries among my countrymen, being more extremely zealous for my ancestral traditions. Listen, if there was anyone who had done religion, who had tried out everything that religion had to offer and done it to the extreme, it was Paul. If anyone could say, I have tried religion, it was the Apostle Paul. Listen to how he describes himself in Philippians chapter 3, sort of his resume, if you will. Listen to how he describes himself. I was circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. In regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church, and as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. Paul had undergone all of the right rituals at all of the right time and all of the right ways. He had an impeccable Jewish lineage. The Pharisees were highly educated in the law. Nowadays, we might look at Paul and we might say a guy like him has a PhD in Old Testament studies. Paul was highly educated in the law. He was zealous for keeping. He said, I was faultless in keeping the law. Now, that's a pretty big claim. That's a pretty high bar to set to say he was faultless. But listen, the Pharisees were the extremists of the extreme. And he said there in verse 14, he said, I was more extremely zealous than the rest of them. The Pharisees were extreme in how they kept the law, but I was even more so. This was Paul's background. This was his resume. This is who he was in religion. But then verse 15, but when God, something happened in Paul's life that was an amazing turnaround, an amazing moment when God entered my life. Something significant happened to Paul that religion was absolutely powerless to do. Religion could not change his heart. Religion could not turn him. Religion could not make a new man out of Paul. But when God, I think what Paul came to realize is that man's attempts to get to God have always failed. Every single time. We trace it back to the Tower of Babel. Chase it back all the way to the Garden of Eden. Man's attempts to get to God have always, always failed. It has always absolutely been necessary for God to reach down to us. No matter how good we think we are, no matter how solid our attempt might be, we will always fall short of the glory of God. And Paul said, but when God, verse 15, who had set me apart, even from my mother's womb, called me through his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately consult with flesh and blood. Now, wait a minute. What just happened in Paul's life? There's a dramatic turnaround that took place here. Now, we can't think that Paul suddenly encountered the gospel. Maybe all of a sudden he heard something he had never heard before. It wasn't that Paul suddenly encountered the gospel. Paul knew the gospel. Remember, that was the reason why he was persecuting the church, because they were proclaiming Jesus, faith alone in Jesus Christ. Paul knew the gospel, and he had a blinding, intense hatred for it. That's what drove him to destroy the church, was his hatred for the gospel message. There is absolutely no human explanation for what happened on that Damascus road, that this rabbi who had this blinding hatred for the gospel of Christ in an instant dropped his religion. In an instant, he said, counted it all like a pile of manure. And in an instant, embraced the gospel that he so much hated just a moment ago. There's no human explanation for that. And as Paul points back to his past, and he says, you know what has happened in my life. I tried out religion. I tried everything. The only way that man can respond to this absurd, illogical gospel, thing that makes absolutely no sense to the human heart and the human mind, the only way that we can respond to that is by a supernatural change of heart. And Paul points to that in his life. That's the only when God entered the scene. See, God is not interested in religion, I believe, because it just sets us up for failure. See, the basic premise of religion is this, that if I just try hard enough, if I just do enough things, that one day I'll be exactly what God wants me to be, righteous and perfect. But we realize very quickly, Paul realized this in his life, we realize very quickly that we just absolutely can't do that. I think that's why these Eastern religions have invented the idea of reincarnation. You get a sort of the eternal do-over. You can go back and try it again. You get it wrong this life, that's all right. You got another shot. You can try it again next time. Get it wrong then, or you do it again. You can try it again then. But listen, 100 failed attempts at doing the exact same thing will never result in success. In fact, Paul says over in chapter 3, verse 24, that's exactly the point of the law. That's why God gave us the law. It was our tutor. It was our teacher, so that we could come to realize how far short we fall of God's grace, how far short we fall of his goodness. We realize when we look at the law that we absolutely cannot teach it. We can't keep it. That was the point of it, that it would be our teacher to help us understand that. In fact, he said at the end of chapter 2 that if we were be able to be saved by our religion, then Jesus died in vain. His death on the cross meant absolutely nothing if we could get there by our own religious works. And God is not interested in our religion because it's ineffective in dealing with the pride that plagues the heart of man, that has plagued the heart of man since the Garden of Eden. The pride of man is the one thing that we consistently trip over. Religion exalts man. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 8 that knowledge puffs up. Knowledge brings us up, makes us proud of ourselves. And he said over in Ephesians chapter 2 that if I could earn my salvation by works, then what would I do? I'd boast about it. And I know that you would too. I earned my way into heaven. I belong here. I ought to be here. We would boast about that. That's what religion does. It builds up man and it diminishes God. Listen, when you say God will give you grace, God will love you, he'll grant you mercy and forgiveness, but in order to get that, you've got to do this. When you come with that message, you express the idea that God is really nothing more than a puppet on a string. And that string is controlled by our behavior. When I do enough things, I've backed God into a corner, and he has to give me mercy. He has to give me grace. He has to give me forgiveness. Why? Because I am so very good and I have earned it. And God is not interested in religion because it's ineffective in dealing with the pride that is in our lives. And no matter how we look at it, as Paul points back to his past, what has happened to him, this dramatic, radical change that happened in the Apostle Paul's life, as he points back to that, we realize the conversion of Paul is nothing short of a spiritual miracle. It is absolutely unthinkable that Rabbi Saul would have become the Apostle Paul, except for the miracle of God's grace. And we see that Paul's argument, I think, is pretty conclusive. What religion is powerless to do, only God in his grace is able to do. I think that God is not interested in our religion because it's ineffective. And God is not interested in our religion because of the impact of religion. Jump down to verse 22. He said, I was still unknown by sight to the churches of Judea which were in Christ. But only they kept hearing, he who once persecuted us is now preaching the faith which he once tried to destroy. And they were glorifying God because of me. Listen, here's the bottom line. That before his conversion, Paul's religion only brought glory to Paul. Now, glory, that's a great churchy word, right? We use it all the time. We hear it all the time. We talk about the glory of God. Glory means nothing more than this: admiration, praise, honor. That's what glory means. And Paul's religion, prior to his conversion, Paul's religion only brought admiration, praise, and honor to Paul. You see how he described himself. I was advancing beyond my peers. I imagine the other Pharisees looked at Paul and said, man, there's a rising star. You want to know what the ideal Pharisee looks like? Look at Saul. Look at how he's rising. Look at his zeal. Look at what he's doing. Maybe even young Hebrew boys, if they would have had posters on the wall of their bedroom, they would have had Saul the Pharisee posters hanging in their bedroom. He was the one they emulated. His religion only brought glory to him. Religion's like that. Listen, if I'm saved by grace after all I can do, then who brought about the majority of my salvation? I did. I got myself 80% there. I got myself 90% there. The grace of God just put me over the top. The majority of my salvation, hey, that's on me. If I am saved by grace after all I can do. But God, speaking through the prophet Isaiah, said this. He said, I am the Lord, and I will not share my glory with anyone. And by the way, that includes that one that stares us back in the mirror every morning. And religion brings glory to us. It brings glory to man. It brought glory to Paul. And the impact of religion drove people away from God. Listen, as Saul ministered, as Saul the Pharisee, he ministered by fear. He ministered by control. People were terrified of Saul. He was destroying the church. And if you read that account in Acts, that is described like a wild animal tearing its prey apart. People were terrified of Saul. It drove people away from God. But in grace, it brought glory to God. It drew people to him when they saw what God had done in his life. I think it's remarkable. Paul said in verse 22, I was unknown by sight to the churches of Judea. And if we back up just one verse in verse 21, he said he had gone to the regions of Syria and Cilicia. Now, those regions, Cilicia, that's where the town of Tarsus is. It's in modern-day Turkey. That's where Paul was from. Now, I'm certain Paul had Google Maps, like everybody does. And so if you look up where Tarsus is versus where the plains of Judea are, they're 1,000 kilometers apart, 600 miles apart. No wonder the churches in Judea didn't know who he was. They had never seen him. He had gone off 600 miles away back to his hometown. He said in chapter 2, verse 1, I was there 14 years. They had never seen him. That's remarkable. They had never personally interacted with Paul. That's remarkable. Why is that remarkable? Because of what he said in verse 24. They are glorifying God because of what he did. They heard the story. They heard about this amazing transformation that happened. They heard about what happened to this one rabbi Saul who was ravaging the church. And this instant turnaround that happened in his life when God got a hold of him. When the grace of God got a hold of Saul. And they heard about it. This thing that happened 14 years ago from some obscure guy we have never actually met. And yet, the testimony of his transformation brought glory to God. They couldn't help but to be drawn to God as a result. Jesus said, if the Son of Man is lifted up, he will draw all men unto himself. And Jesus told this parable in Luke chapter 18. And I think it captures the impact of religion versus the impact of grace. Starting in verse number 9 of Luke 18. Luke said, to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everyone else, those are the self-righteous Pharisees, the religious ones, the ultimate ones of religion in that day, Jesus told this parable. And Jesus said, two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and he prayed, God, I thank you I'm not like other people, robbers and evildoers and adulterers, or even like this tax collector over here. I fast twice a week, and I give a tenth of all that I get. Now, we ought to do those things, absolutely. It's all about who is the Pharisee glorifying. I fast, and I give a tenth. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He wouldn't even look up to heaven. He beat his breast, and he said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus said, I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted. I believe that God is not interested in religion because religion exalts self. But in grace, realize, like this tax collector, in grace we realize that you and I are really nothing more than one beggar showing another beggar where to find a loaf of bread. And I think this message that Paul wrote to this church 2,000 years ago is just as relevant today as it was then. It's just as relevant as when a young German monk 500 years ago named Martin Luther preached this same exact message. It is just as relevant today. I'll close with this. A lady I used to work with, she's a professing Christian. She posted this on Facebook this past week. Her father just passed away. And she posted this on Facebook, sort of a tribute to her dad. And she noted his great accomplishments, that he served in World War II, that he had this amazing career. He had been married 67 years. That in itself is just amazing. Married 67 years, raised 7 children, earned a PhD, a loving father and husband. Sounded like a great guy. Wished I could have met him. And then she ended like this. Now, I'll remind you, she is a professing believer in Christ. She said this, "Dad, you've earned your spot in heaven." And if it were just that one person, I could dismiss it. A recent survey indicated nearly half of evangelical Christians believe that exact same thing. That our standing before God is a mixture of his grace and my works. This is a relevant message for the church today. And let me ask you this morning, what about you? Are you still holding out hope, the empty hope, that your religion will one day be enough? Or are you hanging on with everything you've got to the gospel that says, despite who you are and despite what you've done, that God's grace and mercy is your only hope? Now, in a moment, we're going to have a time of invitation. And if you're here this morning and you have been hanging on to the hope of religion, boy, I hope I do enough, and one day if I stand before God, I'm going to point to all the great things I've done. And if that's what you're hoping, the Spirit has spoken to your heart today. This time of invitation is for you. You just step forward and come down to the front and just tell me, I need to know Jesus. Let me introduce you to the one who died for you that you might experience God's grace and mercy. Or maybe you're here this morning, the Holy Spirit has spoken to you in some other way, and you need to just come to this altar and just in repentance and prayer, just spend some quiet time in prayer right there in the aisle where you are. However God is speaking to you this morning as we come into this time of invitation, you respond and follow his leadership. Would you pray with me? And Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your reminder of who you are and who we are. Lord, we thank you as we look in your word, as we come to the truth of your gospel. Lord, we thank you for the reminder that there is absolutely no way that we could ever come to you on our own. No way that we could ever earn our spot on our own. And Father, we just pray that as we enter this time of invitation right now, Lord, if there's one here in the congregation this morning that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, has never repented of their sins, never trusted in you, Father, I pray as your Holy Spirit continues to speak, as your Holy Spirit continues to lead, Father, give them the boldness to step out, to settle that matter today, to not go one more minute without settling their eternity with you. Father, for your children that are here today, and maybe we've accepted the lie of the world that our standing before you is a mixture of works and grace. Maybe we've passed that on to people. Father, I pray that you would just convict our hearts this morning. Lord, that we would come back to biblical Christianity, to preach the only gospel of truth. Father, would you continue to speak in these next few moments? And Father, give us the courage to follow you and to step out in whatever way you're leading. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this